In recent weeks, video game streamer and professional bullshit artist Ben Shapiro, I mean Destiny, has gone on to debate small YouTube creator Pogan as well as co-op man himself, Richard D. Wolf. In both debates, Destiny made an opening statement where he makes his case for capitalism, as well as posing a number of questions that supposedly no socialist has been able to answer adequately.
Consequently, there are four major hurdles that no socialist I've spoken to has adequately addressed, and they are as follows.
Well, as you have probably guessed from the title, viewer, that is the reason why we are here today. To give several long but bulletproof answers to the major hurdles that Destiny has presented. I'm not going to lie, viewer. Unlike the rest of the Twitch stream debate bro trash out there, I have at the very least a modicum of respect for Destiny, not just because he's an OG on the platform, but because he's not out here LARPing like he's some kind of leftist revolutionary or the leader of a movement. He's not going around parading himself like some sort of socialist while spewing a bunch of liberal propaganda. Nope, he's just an honest-to-God, straightforward, basic bitch lib, and I respect that about him. I like that he's honest in his sociopathic contempt and disregard for working people as well as those beneath him.
The rioting needs to fucking stop. And if that means like white redneck fucking militia dudes out there mowing down dipshit protesters that think that they could torch buildings at 10 p.m., then at this point they have my fucking blessing, because holy shit, this fucking shit needs to stop. It needed to stop a long time ago.
Okay, so indigenous tribes people, like if you just so wish to, maybe you just enjoy killing people, you think it's not a moral issue to just massacre an entire island of indigenous people who just, you know, who are hostile to outsiders.
If they're not capable of reciprocating, then yeah, go for it.
Really?
It sounds like, really cold, but yeah.
When I remember that when you told me that, though, there's no evidence of communist, of stable communist country in the world. And you know why? Because of capitalism, capitalist country in the world fuck all us up.
It's, I mean, even if that was true, that's not my fault that your economic system is too weak to resist outside pressure. If anything, that's not an argument for capitalism. Well, I'm sorry, like, if your countries roll over because they can't defend themselves, that sounds like a good argument for my system.
Well, I'm sorry, but are you saying...
Yes, indeed. When it comes to Steven, what you see is what you get. Just a guy trying to lawyer his way through every debate and win the argument at all costs, no matter how much he may make himself look and sound like a psycho in the process. But alas, before we get to the questions themselves, I wanted to provide a bit of commentary on the opening statements, because there's quite a bit here to unpack. Okay, so let's get started.
As of March 2021, Americans rank the economy, job markets, jobs, the handling of the coronavirus, leadership in Washington, the foremost important challenges facing our country. Socialist policies would not alleviate any of these concerns. Countries have tried the socialist experiment. Time and time again, this has failed. Doctors in Cuba moonlight as taxi drivers. Countries with socialized health care haven't fared much better than the U.S. in their handling of the coronavirus. And any socialist regime will necessarily involve the bureaucracy of Washington even more heavily in our economy.
Okay, so I don't know what doctors in Cuba working as taxi drivers on the side has to do with whether or not socialist economic policy would do a better job alleviating the pandemic than a capitalist response. I find it to be a bit of a non sequitur with respect to the original arguments, but needless to say, Stephen is dead wrong here. Countries with national healthcare plans have been faring substantially better than those without. Don't get me wrong, I'm one of the last people to say that socialism is when the government does stuff, but the fact of the matter is that virtually every country with a solid national healthcare plan and good state infrastructure is coping with the pandemic substantially better than the United States. The country that for a while was leading the world in new cases and deaths. The country that leaves its healthcare to the magic of the free market. The red social democracies like China, Cuba, and Vietnam, however, have practically stopped the outbreak in its tracks with their respective lockdowns, shutting down all of the afflicted cities, keeping everyone in place for a few weeks, setting up quarantine zones, and limiting freedom of movement as much as possible. And as a result, it has been the countries led by communists that are the ones whom have handled the outbreaks the most effectively, and the European countries, whom too have national healthcare plans of their own, have been relatively successful in their containments of the virus, that is, at least until they opened their own economies back up and botched the release of the vaccine.
Any country that has attempted to realize a fully socialist economy has either failed completely, such as in the case of the USSR, destroyed large swaths of their economy, such as in Venezuela, or been forced to embrace more neoliberal economic policies to realize true growth in their economy, such as in China or Vietnam. Liberal market policies work better in both theory and practice when it comes to efficiently allocating resources to maximizing the economic productivity of any country, and we've seen this play out time and time again across a wide variety of markets and countries throughout history across the globe.
Okay, so on the points of China and India was never a socialist country, and all of the most dramatic improvements in living conditions, as well as the construction of the country's current industrial base, happened on the watch of Mao Zedong. Sure, economic growth and GDP began to soar after China's liberalization. However, not only was the country already growing very rapidly under Mao, there is evidence that China would have grown just as quickly, if not faster, had they maintained the socialist road and many of the Mao-era economic policies. On the point of the USSR, their centrally planned economy transformed the former Russian Empire from an agrarian peasant's backwater into an industrial superpower practically overnight, capable of providing a respectable standard of living for its people, crushing the march of the most powerful army in modern history, becoming the first spacefaring nation, and America's number one geopolitical competitor for decades. Now, given its starting conditions, the pressures that it had to face, possessing a fraction of the time and resources of the Western colonial powers, and looking at where it went in its time and what it achieved in such a short period, is that a testimony of socialism's weakness or of its strength? And with the restoration of capitalism in Russia and the former SSRs, we saw a massive uptick in poverty, drug and crime-related mortality in the 90s, a dip in life expectancy, and a crash in fertility rates. The former SSRs had roughly a third of its GDP sucked out of their countries at the time, as state assets were privatized and auctioned off to foreign investors at a fraction of their cash value. And to this day, most former socialist countries have barely recovered, and are now back to where they were economically decades ago. Only now they endure massive income inequality, rampant crime, drug abuse, and human trafficking, and have gone from being self-sustaining economies to merely exporting a single good, oil. Russia is now a wasteland ruled by oligarchs and the mob, and the dismantling of socialism has been a massive step backwards, not forward. And as for the case of Venezuela, Maduro just needs to suck it up and get his hands bloody. He needs to stop compromising with capital and just declare a national emergency, scramble the military, roll into the manufacturing plants and farms with the tanks, seize the means of production, nationalize and socialize all industry, shut down all airports to keep the capitalists from fleeing, and then proceed to liquidate them as a class. Venezuela, in my eyes, is nothing more than a testimony to the limits of reformism and democratic socialism. Venezuela has a Maduro, when what it really needs right now is a Stalin.
Oftentimes, people like Richard Wolff will bring up the boom-bust cycle as though it's an inherent flaw of capitalism, but I believe I speak for most when I say that a boom-bust cycle is preferable to just going bust, as so many socialist countries have.
What a load of bullshit! The socialist countries grew their economies linearly for decades, and the only time that they experienced recession was only with the dismantling of socialism and the restoration of capitalism.
Consequently, there are five major hurdles that no socialist I have ever spoken to has adequately addressed, and they are as follows. Number one, what level of violence is acceptable for you to reach our socialist state?
How much violence are you willing to tolerate to maintain the current capitalist system? Globally, 20 million people die on a yearly basis from poverty-related causes and preventable illness. And considering all of the wars and non-stop U.S. military adventurism, we can throw millions more bodies onto the pile on a decade-by-decade basis. Or how about the first two world wars, which were driven primarily by the needs of the imperialist powers to conquer and dominate new markets and cheap reserves of labor? Or how about the tens of millions of corpses used to fuel British colonialism in Southeast Asia? In the last 300 years, using the same metrics that anti-communists use to calculate excess deaths by economic system, capitalism has killed scores more people needlessly during its time than socialism ever has. And no, this isn't whataboutism, because the argument being levied whenever people bring up the numbers game is that capitalism leads to less death and suffering, and is therefore the preferable system. a claim that is easily disputed when one takes a mere cursory glance at the history. As for how much violence am I willing to tolerate to bring about socialism? The answer is however much it takes to get the job done. It's not that we communists like violence. We don't. Nor are we going to be the ones who bring the violence. We simply understand its historic role. Ideally, the transition could be bloodless. All the ruling class need to do is relinquish their wealth and power and descend back into the ranks of the proletariat. However, because historically, the ruling class has never given up their wealth peacefully, and since the ownership of that vast amount of private property is a form of violence in and of itself, and the ruling class is more than willing to unleash violence and terror upon the general populace to protect it, it stands to reason that any violence that we unleash upon the bourgeoisie is self-defense. Next question.
Number two, how do we decide which businesses are allowed to exist in a socialist society without allowing private capital investment?
The answer is that it will be done based on political decisions drawn up by the economic planners rather than by private capitalists. Since profits are no longer in command, and we're going to need to transition to a steady-state zero-growth economy in the future anyways if we want to continue to persist on this planet, what this means is that all production will be done in pursuit of use value over exchange value, meeting human need, providing a respectable and fulfilling standard of living for our people without it coming to the detriment of another group of people or the environment. And as for the decision-making process itself, I imagine that a combination of open-source planning, direct voting on initiatives and issues, as well as sortition democracy for choosing qualified experts and planners for important decision-making roles, could be utilized. Under such a system, people would still have the freedom to be self-employed, or even start a small cooperative of their own. However, all forms of exploitation, from wage labor to rent, intellectual property, dividends, and interest, would be eliminated. Such a system would free up massive pools of resources, time, and energy, and massively curtail the waste, inefficiency, and inherent violence needed to perpetuate a ruling class.
Three, is any form of investment whatsoever allowed in a socialist society for an expansion of business?
I don't know why liberals think that there's no investment or economic development under socialism, as though capitalists are a uniquely superhuman phenomenon that are the sole source of wealth creation for humanity and God's gift to mankind. What part of the Eastern Bloc grew their economies linearly for decades, do you not understand? The state can invest too, you know. The difference is that investments would be going on outside of the context of private enrichment.
Four, how are labor markets determined in a socialist society? And five, how do we calculate which goods and services a nation needs if we do away with the commodity form?
Or how can we calculate which goods and services a nation needs if we do away with the commodity form? The calculation problem has never been adequately addressed nor solved for any country. And even in the case where it's brought up within businesses, your final inputs and outputs are still decided by market conditions, not votes or councils.
Okay, so the last two can be lumped together and best described as the economic calculation problem, a question that liberals have been begging an answer for by socialists for literal decades, a question that has been addressed numerous times on multiple occasions by economists, physicists, and econophysicists, and despite the fact that it has been repeatedly dispelled as a non-issue time and time again, once again, every couple of years, liberal economists will come around and cleverly reword it and pose the same question yet again. As explained by Pogan in his debate with Destiny, the problem with the economic calculation problem is that it is fundamentally a loaded question that depends on us Marxists rejecting the labor theory of value and accepting marginal utility at the onset. The way that you determine labor markets and allocation in a socialist economy is through a general economic plan, and hard economic calculation can be done utilizing modern computers and information technology. In Cockshott's book, Towards a New Socialism, he has multiple chapters devoted to explaining the intricacies of socialist planning. But the premise comes down to this. It costs a fixed amount of abstract human labor to harvest resources X, Y, and Z, and then it takes a given amount of noted resources to produce commodities A, B, and C. The thing that unifies these six articles is the average labor time it takes to harvest, produce, and distribute the noted commodities, and thus, within a planned economy, the labor markets would be dictated by the labor inputs needed to reproduce civilization, with the prices of goods tied to the socially necessary labor time needed in order to produce them, with labor payments in the form of time-based labor credits and production targets set according to demand inputs denoted from the average aggregate production/consumption rate. During my tenure in college, there is a concept in electrical engineering that I studied known as control systems theory, or the ability to reach a desired amplitude within an analog or digital controller. Controllers are utilized for a variety of applications, from boiler rooms to washing machines, the engine of an automobile, to the thermostat in your house, etc. But let's take the thermostat, for example. Capitalism is very analogous to an on-off controller with respect to fluctuations in the air amp. In a simple on-off control system, when the output target is set to a given temperature, the controller will turn on and will continue to remain on and heat up the house until the target is reached. But then, once it overshoots the target, the controller will turn back off again, and will remain off until temperature drops below the desired target. The long-term effect of this is perpetual oscillation in the air amplifier, never truly hitting the target, simply flickering on and off between it. The on-off controller is generally inaccurate with respect to eliminating feedback error, and will perpetually overshoot and undershoot its target signal, in the same manner that capitalist industry chronically overproduces beyond consumer demand. And then there's the more advanced controller, known as the proportional integral derivative, or the PID controller. The PID will continuously calculate changes in the error amplitude with respect to feedback, and fluctuate according to said changes. So a well-tuned PID is actively working to meet a given target, and when said target changes, its feedback mechanisms will correct any fluctuations in the error until hitting the desired target. The PID is more analogous to socialism, as through the use of information technology and cybernetic feedback mechanisms, economic calculation can be done in real time, with input and output targets being adjusted with respect to feedback error until the steady state error has been eliminated. In the same manner that well-adjusted PIDs are far more accurate than on-off controllers, modern economic calculation using computers, spreadsheets, and IT could be done far more accurately than what the market is capable of.
If one cannot get their idea approved or find sufficient other workers to operate their business with them, is that new business simply not allowed to exist?
Okay, so essentially what he's asking here is, what role do entrepreneurs play under socialism? Well, under my ideal model, I do believe that there should be a competitive outlet with respect to certain types of consumer goods, but it should be friendly competition, be it between competing art studios, video game development cooperatives, sports teams, heavy metal bands, etc. Wherever it is observed that competition genuinely does drive innovation or positive outcomes, then competitive mechanisms can be put into place to realize said outcomes. And if you have a good idea, as many people will have good ideas now that they're not stuck slaving away for 40 to 50 hours a week, if it really is a good idea, then it will be easier than ever before to get in touch with people and gain access to the resources that you need to realize said idea. On the other hand, when it comes to solving large-scale problems that affect us all on a species level, that is something that I personally believe should be left up to the open source and central planning. So on a macroeconomic scale, when it comes to, say, curing cancer, or building a ladder to outer space, or inventing a new branch of mathematics, I for one believe that these are goals that humanity should be united behind as a collective to tackle.
Number two, is any form of investment whatsoever allowed in a socialist society?
Not by private capitalists.
How do businesses raise additional capital for expansion? If I want to expand my business and open new stores, is it contingent upon me finding other workers willing to buy in and own part of my new expansion of business?
The state, as well as local and regional workers' councils, will decide when and where investment takes place. If you have a project or suggestion in mind on a local level, then you can submit such a request to your local council. However, heavy industry, large-scale production, and the general backbone of the economy will be controlled by the state. And the way that capital is gathered for expansion is through the social surplus generated by the country's workforce. Under socialism, you wouldn't need to levy a tax, at least in the capitalist sense of the term, since, at least under my model, money would be abolished. Instead, economic decision-making will be limited by the resources that are available to the country or given region. And with the ruling class out of the way, and without blowing countless billions of dollars on advertising, rents, stock markets, or the wasteful and lavish lifestyles of the wealthy, not only will it massively drive down our carbon footprint, but it will free up a metric fuckton of resources that will be left to the democratic decision-making of the public.
If we remove profit incentives and wages from society, socially dictate where goods and services are allocated, what incentive would anyone have to pursue a socially necessary job that they do not wish to pursue? Would they simply be forced by the government to do so?
Okay, so there are a number of angles of this question that need to be addressed, but generally, there are two sets of reasons why people do not want to perform a given task. The first is because the job is too boring, hazardous, or generally unpleasant, and the second reason is that the task does not interest the individual or satisfy them on a personal level. To incentivize people to do socially necessary tasks that are of the former category, that is, running a wastewater treatment plant, organizing trash in the recycling bins, or clearing out some clogged pipes, these tasks should be first and foremost treated as chores that are shared amongst the commune. That is to say, this work is compulsory, but the workload is shared and spread amongst everyone in such a way that each person has to do as little of it as possible out of their spare time. People would need only to volunteer a few hours of their week to performing such tasks of maintenance, and within a properly socialized context, where individuals are plugged into a community that they depend upon on a regular basis, that they regularly participate in on a daily basis, I imagine it wouldn't be hard to get some of them to volunteer from time to time to do community service. We already see this kind of behavior in modern Stone Age societies as a living testament that it can be done. Alternatively, at least in the lower phase of communism, a pay differential, anywhere from 25 to 50% could be levied to incentivize people to take on those dirty jobs that need to be done for the simple reason that if there is more material risk and effort involved in doing certain types of work, then there should be greater material access. I've spoken to some socialists and anarchists that are against paying people different amounts according to their effort, but the problem is that if you do this, you're just going to piss off the people who are exceptionally hard workers and wants to prosper off of the sweat of their brow, so to speak. So at least until the higher stage of communism, bourgeois right will be a lingering contradiction that will eventually have to be addressed. As for complex or high-skilled labor that is not necessarily dangerous or tedious, however requires years of education in order to reproduce, such as doctors, scientists, engineers, chemists, physicists, etc., well, the best way to produce more of those is to foster a culture of learning and education that values those skill sets, a culture that actively encourages and nurtures learning and self-improvement, that treats the hard sciences as a participatory activity on part of the group, rather than a specialized skill set that elite individuals learn in exchange for a 100k salary. Within a communist society, I would be more than willing to bet that without the massive baggage of students' loan debt being shackled around people's ankles, without having to work bullshit jobs 40 to 50 hours a week to meet ends meet, that sap all of people's creative and innovative energy out of them and turn them into couch potatoes the last 4 to 5 hours of the day, I would be willing to wager that within such a context, in a world where people are actively encouraged to self-improve and are brought up in a welcoming environment that wants to see them improve, that we would have no shortage of scientists, engineers, mathematicians, doctors, artists, programmers, etc. And that's the last question. I genuinely feel sorry for Destiny. He can't see the forest for the trees. The man is so cynical, so mired in the rat race of the debate bro discourse, that he seems to have forgotten how to learn, and only seems to be interested in winning the argument at all costs, even if he is clearly on the incorrect side. I have listened to his debates with Wolf, Pogan, and Jack Angstrich, and in each one of these debates, it is so obvious that he is arguing in bad faith, from the condescending attitude that he has towards his opponents, to his unwillingness to learn and understand their point of view, to the asking of very loaded questions that he doesn't even want real answers to. It appears to me, and anybody else who has been paying attention, that Destiny doesn't just not know socialism, he evidently doesn't want to know it. And the reason why he doesn't want to know it is because he benefits from capitalism personally, making a six-figure-a-year salary doing what he does. So it's in his material interests to not understand what Marxism or socialism is about, much like the young Earth creationist priest debating evolutionary scientists. It is in their interest not to understand. And thus, it is in this way that Destiny could be considered the Kent Hovind of political discourse online. A person hell-bent on not understanding science, for their paycheck depends on it. Anyways, that's all I have to say for now. Shout out to my Patreons. Your gratuity is greatly appreciated, as always. You are the stars that continuously sow into my light and make this channel project possible. So, 1,000 times, thank you to you. Well, that's all I have to say for now. I'm going to bed. Good night, guys.